Well, so far this year, The Space Between Us is the sappiest, cheesiest movie I've seen in 2017. And I've seen a movie called The Book of Love. I haven't reviewed that, but I've seen a movie called The Book of Love. And The Space Between Us is a much cheesier movie. Now, most of you probably know this, but the person who wrote The Space Between Us also wrote Collateral Beauty. So if you like that movie, you might like this. If you didn't like that movie, well, The Space Between Us suffers many of the same problems. Well, anyway, this movie is about a mission to Mars, and they're about to cultivate it and try to make it into a colony. They're gonna try to make it a livable place. The first group of astronauts that are sent there, well, one of them turns out, hey, she's pregnant. So she gives birth to a baby on Mars. Well, this whole baby has been developed in zero gravity and then on Mars, and so he may not be able to make the travel back to Earth. So the executives have to make a decision and have to keep this kid secret. Well, this kid's name is Gardner, and he eventually grows up to be Asser Butterfield, or however you pronounce his name, Asa or Asha? Asa? And all Gardner wants to do is to go to Earth and go to a different place, see where his mother came from, find out who his father is, and fall in love with this girl that he's been chatting with constantly. A foster kid named Tulsa, who is played by Britt Robertson. Well, eventually he is able to go to Earth thanks to some surgery making his bones denser or something like that. He escapes, joins up with the foster kid, joins up with Britt Robertson, and then they go on a road trip seeking out his father. And along the way, we get a cheesy romance with these two young individuals. Now, when I saw this on Tuesday, I saw this after Rings. It was around a 4:20 showing or something like that. I go in there about 2 minutes before the movie's supposed to start, or at least the trailer start, because we get 15 minutes of previews. I go in there, I'm looking, I'm the only one in the theater. I'm like, great, I get two private screenings, yes! And then they all started pouring in. We had almost an entire theater. Yeah, people were rolling into this movie just as the movie started. And you know what? I had a fun time because of that theater, because a lot of people realized midway through just how cheesy and awful this movie is, and everyone started having a fun time making fun of it. And so I got into it. I didn't say anything. I didn't comment on things, but I was having a blast watching how bad this movie is. But maybe you have to have a huge crowd of people with the same opinions in order to really enjoy it. Because I wonder what it would be like if I was alone watching this movie. It probably wouldn't be as fun. Now, what did I ultimately like about this film? Well, the sets on Mars and the visual effects, they all looked really good. Now, obviously, we've seen really great Martian movies lately, like The Martian, and there was a whole series, was it Science Channel or History Channel, something along those lines. And it has that same visual quality, the same feel to it, and it was acceptable. And I think Asa Butterfield did good with what he had, because honestly, the character is very hit or miss for me, but I think he did a decent job with that character. I also feel that him and Britt Robertson have a good chemistry together. I feel they could do really good in a romance together, just not this movie, because the lines they're given are awful. Honestly, I wish I could have remembered some of those lines, because there is some really... Alright, I'll get into that later, though. That's the bad. The point is, they had good chemistry together. I want to see them in another movie together, in another romance, a better romance, and I think they would be fine. There was a few other actors and actresses that did an okay job, but nothing grand, nothing spectacular, and nothing awful. And there were some really cheesy moments that are just laugh-out-loud hilarity, and there are moments throughout this movie that are so bad they're good, so I have to count that as some of the good. Because there are definitely moments where I was laughing at its ridiculousness and its cheesiness. Other than that, most of this movie was just plain bad. Now, I haven't reviewed Collateral Beauty yet. I wanted to, but I got so busy and got so far behind on movie reviews Maybe I'll wait till it comes out on DVD or something so I can get the whole thing and do a major review where I go through the entirety of the film or all the crazy stuff that happens, because I'm actually kind of surprised that a lot of people actually think it's a masterpiece and feel it's Oscar worthy and that it has a good message. Anyway, a lot of the same flaws I have with Collateral Beauty, I have with Space Between Us as well, especially with the writing. First of all, the dialogue is way worse than Collateral Beauty. There's so much cheese, so much just hokiness that it is mind-numbingly terrible, and it just makes you want to gag. I felt like I was choking. It was so bad. And again, I wish I would have remembered them enough or wrote them down after I saw the movie, but now it's a couple days after I saw the movie and I don't remember a darn thing that I found really bad. Like, I remember there was one moment where I just thought, give me a fucking break. And I just can't even remember that line. Very similar to Collateral Beauty, some of the tone shifts in this movie are so crazy and ridiculous. Now look, when it comes to the tone of a movie, I don't feel like it needs to be monotone. I don't feel like it needs to have all one tone, whether it's dark or romantic or anything like that. I do like movies with multiple tones, but this movie, it goes from one extreme to the next. There's a scene in Collateral Beauty that I remember where it's ultra sad, and then suddenly it's supposed to be happy and lighthearted, like next scene, and it's ridiculous. Let me give an example in The Space Between Us, since this is a movie review of The Space Between Us, not Collateral Beauty. There's a scene where Gary Oldman and the other scientists that raised Gardner on Mars, where they're realizing, yeah, Gardner might not have much time. His heart is becoming too big and swollen because it has to pump harder on Earth's gravity or something like that. So it's becoming inflated, it's becoming inflamed. And he might not have much time. He's gonna die. It's really drastic news as these two are talking to each other and realizing, hey, we gotta find him fast because he's already on his road trip with his love interest. So it's a really sad scene. It's a really, like, oh my god, there's impending doom with our main character. How is he going to survive? And so it goes from that kind of tone to suddenly a happy-go-lucky tone where they're driving down the countryside, there's a bunch of hot air balloons, Gardner is sticking his head out the window, it's like, yeah! And then there's this song that's like, oh, kind of that happy kind of song, and I'm like, what? This is the extremes that the tone goes in this movie, and it does it in Collateral Beauty as well. Like I said, I like multiple tones in a movie. That doesn't affect me that much. But when it's something that drastic, when it's like, oh, we're supposed to be sad, and like there's an impending doom, and then like, oh no, forget all of that. Let's be happy. Be happy. Yay! What the fuck? I really don't like Gardner's character when he goes to Earth because it's very hit or miss. On Mars, he's smart. He was raised by scientists. He knows how to do a bunch of things. He does a lot of hacking in this movie as well. And then when he goes to Earth, and I know that's supposed to be like, oh, he's like an alien in this movie. Oh, because he technically is. He was born on Mars. Oh, he doesn't know what this is, and he doesn't know what this is. But it gets to a ridiculous point where he looks like the stupidest person ever. Now I understand, there are things he's not going to know when he goes to Earth, and he's new to that thing, and there is a beauty within it, and there is something funny within it too. But all I was thinking about is, you know what? He's able to hack into this computer, he's able to hack the network so that he can talk to people on Earth and communicate with people on Earth. So he's probably able to hack and get research on Earth, see images of Earth, and study it because he wants to be on Earth, so that's going to be fascinating to him. So more than likely, he's seen a lot of things about Earth and knows what Earth is like. He's probably seen a bunch of animals too. There's one part where he looks, he's actually on Earth and he does see a real dog in real life, and he's just like, wow. Kind of like, oh, that's neat, you know? But then he sees a horse and he's like, whoa, what the, what is that? What is happening?
Whoa, what is?
It's just a horse.
I'm on a road trip with an insane person.
It goes ridiculous, and it's just... What? Shouldn't you... Isn't that one of the things you probably could have researched about Earth? I mean, you already know what a dog is, so you probably looked up animals, and... Like, there's one thing, when he sees the ocean for the first time, that is completely understandable, because even if you see a picture, this is a very different thing seeing it in real life rather than a picture. And some of those things, that's understandable, but the crazy reactions are sometimes really stupid. And even though I said that he and Britt Robertson had chemistry together, I don't feel that Britt Robertson was really good in this movie. She really didn't feel believable. She's supposed to be this foster kid that's a bit of a rebel and doesn't trust anyone, supposed to be a tough girl, and you really don't, at least I didn't buy into it whatsoever. Now granted, there is a twist in the movie, I guess, where you find out that she really isn't a tough girl and she's just playing off to be a tough girl, but she still definitely has trust issues, and so it's like, okay, that's fine. You don't really feel that way as the movie progresses. You feel like, oh, she's just being really bad and very ungenuine. I don't know, there's something about it that I just didn't like, and I think there is a great opportunity there with a person that's like, hey, I'm from Mars, this is crazy, for having a relationship with someone who has trust issues, and then that having conflict is like, I don't know if I can trust you, dude. I don't trust anyone in all my life, and the first time I thought I could actually be real with someone, now you're saying you're from Mars. Like, what the hell? Like, I see some opportunity in that, and it just doesn't feel like it's good enough in this movie. Oh, and let's talk about some of the criminal activity in this movie, because they do a few things here and there that is definitely criminal, and there's no consequences for it whatsoever. Now look, I know there are action heroes and crazy movie characters that get away with a lot of crazy stuff, even though it's criminal. But you don't expect it in a family-friendly film that's rated PG, I think it's rated PG, I don't know if it's PG-13, but a romance thing, you don't expect it. Like, there was a little kid in the theater, I know for sure, because there was like a 5-year-old or maybe less than so, who kept getting out of his seat, going down my row, looking at me, seeing me eat the popcorn, would get closer, and every time I look at him, he'd go... And then he'd run off, and then he'd go behind the seat, he'll be on the end of the aisle, and just peeking at me, every time I look with my popcorn, he's like, ooh. I don't know why I went on that tangent, but in this movie, our main characters, to get from place to place, they don't have a car. So what do? Well, first they steal a plane, and it's like, okay, well, that is her foster father's plane, and he does crop dusting with that, and so I was like, okay, I can buy it. And then later on, when that crashes, oh yeah, that crashes, and there's this huge explosion when it hits the barn. I'm not a good expert on explosions and why planes would blow up, but when it crashes into a barn, and not even crashing from the sky, but they land it, they just have no brakes, and it slowly goes into the barn, hits the barn inside, and then boom, huge explosion. But then after that plane is destroyed, they steal a car with an app. Yeah, she uses an app that hacks into the car. Then what do? Well, they have to steal a truck later on. And then they steal a car from a hospital. Yeah, there's a point where they're at the hospital and they have to escape because people are coming for them. So they get out and they notice that there's someone being dropped off in the hospital. Someone that's in critical pain probably, or definitely has a cast on. He's getting out of the car. The person who drove him there is getting the stuff, getting out. And it's like, and they're hurrying. They're trying to get into the hospital really quickly. And then our main heroes come out, take the car, and drive away. No consequences whatsoever. That's kind of like what Collateral Beauty was, where the whole thing was basically criminal act with people trying to betray their friend and try to sell out a company out from under them because that friend is depressed and isn't doing anything because they lost their kid. And we're supposed to root for the bad guys in that movie. Now, it's not that extreme as Collateral Beauty, but I find it crazy that this is another one of those films where criminal activities happen and you're supposed to be happy with it, or there's no consequences and you're just like, oh, whatever, steal whatever car you want. Oh, another thing to add with tone, there's sometimes when the tone and the music really just doesn't feel right for the scene it's supposed to be in. Like, there are scenes where it's supposed to feel like it's meant to be intense or suspenseful, or at least I feel it would have been better that way, but it's done in a lighthearted tone that's like, oh yeah, whatever. Take all the time you want. Like, there's this one scene where they go into a diner, they have to look up something, but they don't have any device to look things up and go on the internet. And so they go in there, they notice this family go to the bathroom, and they left their tablet on the table, on the dining table. So they go in there, they hack into that, and they start looking up information, but then the Wi-Fi goes down. So yeah, this could be an intense, suspenseful scene, because they're like, oh, we gotta get this done before they get out of the bathroom. Instead of just, I guess they could have just stolen it, like they steal all the other cars, but I guess that wouldn't be suspenseful. And then there's this guy sitting behind her that just turns around and is like, yeah, yeah, the Wi-Fi doesn't work that well. Use the Wi-Fi from across the street. I love that scene. That was actually really funny. Even though I don't think it was meant to be funny, I think it was actually just done bad, and that's why I laughed about it. Oh, and then the romance that blossoms between these two characters. Like I said, I believe their chemistry. I want to see these two actors in a romance together. The characters, on the other hand, there's no chemistry between the characters themselves, and there's not a believable progression into, oh, we love each other now and we'll do anything for each other. First off, the first time he actually comes to the school, he's been gone for a while because it's a mission, so he can't contact her when they're in space, I guess. Then he goes into quarantine, so she hasn't heard from him in a long time. She gets pissed about it. It's like, hey, what about blah blah blah? It's like, hey, I'm from Mars or whatnot, blah 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 blah. Eventually, after the classroom incident where he drenches himself because he goes to the chemical shower in case you get chemicals on you or acid or something like that, the emergency eye washing station and shower. Anyway, after that, then he finally discusses that, hey, I'm from Mars and whatnot, and she asks about parents or something. This is ridiculous, okay? I love this part because of how bad it is and how terrible it just shows you how the dialogue is. There's a moment where she asks about his parents or whatnot. He goes, yeah, my mother's dead. I don't know my father. I want to see him or whatnot. And he mentions that his mother's dead, and he goes, yeah, I killed her. And it's meant for laughs, and you're just like, holy crap, she's with a crazy person, you know, it's like, or she thinks he's a crazy person. We know that she died in childbirth, right? But he says, oh yeah, I killed her. Like, no, so nonchalantly. And then I'm like, okay, well, now they're in the scene together when they're driving. And I'm like, okay, he must explain that it was in childbirth, because who in their right mind would go with someone who says, yeah, I killed my parents, I killed my mother. But then it's really funny when several scenes later, after this whole chase where you realize that Gary Oldman and them, they found out where he's been heading and where he went, and so the CIA and all of them are chasing after him, and they run away on a plane ride. So you're thinking, okay, people are really after him. This is suspicious. And then later on, when they're alone together in a car, a couple scenes later, she finally goes, so you said you killed your mother?
So, Gardner, when you said that you killed your mother, what exactly did you mean by that?
She died giving birth to me.
And I'm like, wait, he didn't say that it was a childbirth? And so she helped him escape? Wouldn't she think that, oh, well, he must have really killed his mother. I shouldn't help them. I should turn him in. But no, it's like, what? I know it's really hard to explain, but the sequence and when they explain each other or explain what really happened is just the way it's edited. It makes you think, why would this character be with this character if they think, oh, he killed his mother? Speaking of which, the childbirth scene was a little ridiculous too. It goes from regular labor, painful, obviously, but what you'd expect from a movie. And she gives birth, she looks completely fine, exhausted or whatnot, and she holds her baby, she's like, oh, and it's like, oh. And then next thing you know, she goes into convulsions out of nowhere and just goes, I mean, it literally looks like an alien is about to pop out of her chest. That's the kind of convulsion she has. And it feels, and it's like, Alright, I know she's gonna die, but this felt like it was out of nowhere and out of the blue. I don't know how women die from childbirth. I don't know what it's like. I'm not an expert on that when they die from childbirth. But there's something about this movie that felt completely off and wrong. Oh, and then back to the creepy romance. There are moments in this movie where it is creepy in the romance, even though it's meant to be innocent. Like, there's a scene where Asher Butterfield is driving the car and she's the passenger. He's driving the car. She's like, hey, eyes on the road, not me, and whatnot. He's like, oh, but you're beautiful. And she's like, oh, you can't say that and stuff. And she goes into detail about how people don't say what they really feel and whatnot. Or maybe that was before that. I don't know. It was somewhere around this time when eventually he's driving the car and he puts his hand on her lap. And she's wearing a dress, so it's a bare lap. And they're like, oh, that's fine, that's cute, whatnot. Then his hand starts going a little further up. And I started thinking, wait a minute, is this going to take a different turn than I expected? And it's supposed to be innocent or whatnot. Obviously, it probably didn't actually go further up her lap than, well, you know. But as the scene progressed, all I was thinking about, is this supposed to be romantic? And it's no progression to this that it feels, that where it feels like, oh, they're going to have sex now because there's progression to the romance. This feels like it comes out of left field. But then later on, they're in the desert, they're at a campfire. Next thing you know, they're naked, they're underneath. Yeah, as this point happened, I was like, oh shoot, there's a little kid in this movie still. I mean, there's no nudity, but I'm like, there's a little kid in this scene. And these young actors are naked underneath the sleeping bag. And it started looking like it was going to get to a point where it's like, okay, they're going to have sex, aren't they? Whoa. I mean, there are moments where it gets a little creepy. And it's not creepy in the fact that they have sex or whatnot. Well, they don't, actually. But it's not creepy in that fact. It's just that the movie, how it progresses, even though it's not the same tone, but how it progresses, it almost feels like stalkerish and creepy in that way. Like, I don't buy their relationship or the character's relationship, and so it just doesn't feel right. The whole point of this journey is to find his father. Well, because I knew what the twists were in Collateral Beauty and seeing what kind of twists happen in that and with the relationships and whatnot, as I'm watching The Space Between Us, I'm thinking, this is the same writer. I bet this is how the father is going to be. I bet this is what the real father is. I bet this is the twist. Sure enough, it is. But even if I didn't watch Collateral Beauty, I probably would have figured out who the real father is due to the overacting and over-exaggeration this actor has throughout the entirety of the film. It felt like, yeah, this is going to actually be the real father because of how affected he is of the mother's death, how affected he is by the child and how he wants to save the child and how much overacting there is. But I will say there are some people in the theater, I don't know if they predicted it or not, or if they were just making fun of it, but there was one person in the back, as soon as it happened, they go, seriously? And then there was these two people in front of me, these two dudes that were together watching the movie, and I was having a blast watching them when this twist happens, because there's this one guy, he's like, wait, huh? And the other Tommy's like, so that's, and then the other guy's like, yeah, that's, this person's his father. The other guy's like, what? Oh, damn! Like, his feet are kicking up and everything. It was hilarious to watch. So the crowd of people watching this movie with me made it really enjoyable and made it easier to make fun of. There's probably a lot more things I can go into detail with, but if you don't like cheesy young adult novel related movies, this has that feeling to it and you're probably not gonna like it, unless you like really making fun of really bad romance films. If you're going into it wanting it to be more sci-fi, guess what? There's not a lot of sci-fi in this movie. You're gonna be completely disappointed. To be honest, I think the only people that are going to like this movie are the people that like Collateral Beauty. And even then, Collateral Beauty, while is definitely a worse film in my opinion, does things a lot better than The Space Between Us. At least when it comes to acting-wise and character-wise. Oh, and I forgot to mention. There's one thing I really hate about this movie. They tried to make a, I don't know if this is an actual classic movie. It's a foreign film in this movie. It's a German film in this movie. So I don't know if it's an actual real film. But it's a film in this movie about this angel that comes to Earth, watching over humans, falls in love with a human, so falls down to her, and he's no longer an angel. He's going to be human again. Gardner is watching this while in Mars, and I'm just thinking, okay, if they're going to relate to this some way in the movie, this is going to be classic cheese and it's going to be ridiculous. And sure enough, it comes up through this movie where they try to have parallels to that. There's even this one moment where she has to go to class. This is when he finally meets her for the first time in school. She's like, I have to go to class. You wait here. And so he's waiting in the hallway, standing right there, being completely obeying. As she goes up the stairs and looks down at him, suddenly it changes from Gardner to the freaking classic movie where a girl is looking up at the angel. And I'm like, oh my God, no. And actually, that was the second movie I saw that day, because Rings did something similar to that, but it was a classic Greek story rather than an actual movie, which unfortunately I forgot to mention in my Rings review. Anyway, this is a very cheesy movie. Like I said, I didn't like it that much. I'm going to give The Space Between Us 1.5, because there are a few things in the elements of storytelling, in the elements of movie making, that did an okay job. And so it bumps it up a little bit in the average. So, did you see The Space Between Us? What did you think about it? Go ahead and comment below. And if you like this movie review and you want to see more, please subscribe and check out my movie reviews of 2015, 2016, or 2017. As always, this is Bruce Gifford, and this was Just My Opinion.